Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for this session in the certificate program in practice-based research methods. My name is Vladimir Bonome. I'm with Clinical Directors Network. The name of today's session is Qualitative Methods and Multi-Method Research Methods in PBRN Research. The virtual session is facilitated by Clinical Directors Network and the N-Squared, a network of virtual training series funded by the AHRQ. This gives you live access and archive access to all the sessions as part of the program. The program is developed in partnership with Dr. Jim Werner and with the support of 8 AHRQ-funded PBRN Centers of Excellence. As always, if you have any questions, please double-click on CDN or CDN help within the chat box, within the participants box, and you can type all your questions that you have within the chat box. For today's session, Dr. Elder will be having some polling questions. As you can see, I magnified the participants box to show you where you can click to participate in the poll. We would like everyone to participate. When the slide comes up asking for your participation, you're going to see the question and then the list of answers, and it's A through D, and please just select for polling reasons. At this time, I'm going to pass it to Dr. James Werner, who's going to introduce today's speaker.
Great. Thank you, Vladimir. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Nancy Elder. Dr. Elder is a family physician and researcher at the University of Cincinnati Department of Family and Community Medicine. She's director of the PBRN, has been for many years, the Cincinnati Area Research and Improvement Group, known as the Caring Network. Dr. Elder attended medical school at the University of Minnesota and did an academic medicine fellowship and family medicine at the University of Missouri. She began using qualitative methods during her fellowship training and has actively used them in her research over the last couple of decades. Specifically, Dr. Elder's used focus groups, interviews, and observations and studies with the AAFP's National Research Network, the Access Community Health Center Network in Chicago, and her Caring Network in Cincinnati to study medical errors, patient safety, and the use of teams in family medicine offices, and chronic pain care. Her qualitative research studies have received grant support from ARC and other funding agencies. So, Dr. Elder, thank you for being with us today. I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you. I hope everybody can hear me. Jim, if I'm doing it wrong, tell me. you know, the topic is supposed to be qualitative research and multi-method research, but we're going to focus mainly on the qualitative component, and we're really going to kind of focus on how to be successful, how to do successful qualitative research. And of course, that means we're going to start with some of the basics. Our goal today is to sort of demystify the process of doing qualitative research. We're going to maximize the excitement and enjoyment of doing qualitative research and hopefully minimize the mess, because qualitative research, for those of you who've done it, can sometimes be a little overwhelming and a little overpowering. Okay, so we're going to start out to see if we can get this polling thing working. So I'd like to know a little bit about your experiences with qualitative research. So click the little A if you have no idea what qualitative research is. B, if you're pretty familiar with research in quantitative studies. I mean, how different can qualitative be, right? C is I'm familiar and comfortable with reading and understanding qualitative research, but haven't actually done any myself. And D is I do so much qualitative research, I could be giving this webinar. So I am hoping that you have all found your little buttons, and because then when it's all done, I should be able to summarize these. This is our test question because I've never quite done this before. And I'm hoping I remember where to summarize the answers from. I think it's under tools.
Okay, just
there were a few people
who were asking. Yeah, I'm just going to go back to that slide real quick.
Yeah,
for those
go ahead.
Of you who are asking.
Oh, I got it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I jumped ahead.
For those of you asking, this is the magnifying participants box. As you can see, it is under participants, under where your name would be. And hold on, let me see if I could. And you would click on this and drop down and select the answer. So I see Liz and Dennis, that it seems like you're having trouble. If you just look at the screen, it is the last box next to the raise your hand button. It has an A on it, and you would select your answer that way. All right. So you could republish again, Dr. Elder. Right.
I will do that. Okay. So most people are at C, which is kind of that, hey, I'm sort of familiar with it, but haven't actually done much myself. A couple of you really are not that familiar at all with it. And a couple of you could be leading this webinar, in which case you can just sit back and drink your coffee or your Coke Zero or whatever you have. All right, so we're going to move on a little bit. That helps me a little bit. You know, this is really weird not having, like, the conversational part, but we're going to do the best we can. Once again, feel free to put into the chat box any questions, comments, or ideas that you have as we go along, and we will stop and look at those along the way. All right, so we're going to start with something really simple. All of you are researchers, so you know basically, you know, kind of how you do any kind of research. You have to define the question. Then you determine your study design. In qualitative research, we don't necessarily talk about, you know, doing your sampling strategy. We talk about identifying the participants. And, of course, we're going to collect the data and analyze the data. So we're going to walk through these a little bit. And, again, any questions along the way, let me know. We're just going to kind of do a little bit of some basics to get us all at the same place. Just like in a quantitative study, defining the research question is the most important step because it's going to set the stage for every other subsequent step. And if you do it poorly, and heaven knows we've all been there or we've helped people, our colleagues who are not researchers, we know that all your work may be for naught. One of my favorites is a colleague at an institution who came to me and said, I collected all this data from this clinical program I've had. Can you help me analyze it? And I said, well, what was your question? And she said, well, I thought I would look at the data and see what it showed me first. So that's the hard way to do research. So how do you know what the right question is? Well, what are you interested in? I mean, the nice thing about being in family medicine, primary care, is that there's so many things we're interested in. So that's never been a problem for me and probably not for many of you as well. So what knowledge gaps exist? If you read some of the articles I had Jim send around, they were really, a couple of them were really kind of nice overviews at a pretty simple level. But one of them talked about, you know, had this discussion about should you even do a literature review before you study because, you know, it might bias you. And I'm telling you that in healthcare, I'm a strong believer that, yes, you should do the literature review before your study. On the other hand, if you are going, you know, to be like Margaret Mead and go out and be an anthropologist and live among a group of people that you want to just truly examine from a naive state, maybe you don't want to do a literature review. But that's not usually what we do in medicine, so you are going to want to see where the knowledge gaps exist. And then, of course, what do you want to do? You can put all those together to help get to the right question. An interesting thing, and probably the thing that one of the things that quantitative people have a lot of trouble with, is the fact that a qualitative research question can change throughout your study. So a quantitative research question better be pretty firm before your data collection. It doesn't mean that you're not going to have additional questions that arise. You're going to have some post hoc analyses and interesting things that come up. Sometimes you may discover, I'm in the process of trying to get a paper published where we didn't even plan it, but we had this nice little, we did a retrospective data collection, and we had this natural difference that was very important among our data that we weren't aware of, and so we went back and looked at our data, and many of you, I'm sure, have been in that same place. But your strongest question, of course, is the one for which your study is designed. Now, I just spent a lot of time telling you how important it is to do a really good qualitative research question before you start your study design, and now I'm telling you, but don't worry about it, you can change your question during data collection. I realize that does seem somewhat paradoxical. But your study question, as we're going to get into, is going to really help you design your study, is going to help you choose your study design, which means you need a good question. But as you start getting your data in, and as you start analyzing it, which in a good qualitative study is often going to happen at the same time by the same researchers, you may find that you need to tweak your question. You may find, you know, I'm asking a lot about the, you know, role of physician families and the time they are able to commit to their work, but really, you know, it's supervisors who seem to be the key factor, and I haven't asked any questions about supervisors, so maybe that's where I need to go. So sometimes you may find that as you're looking at the data, you're going to do some changes. All right. Okay, we're going to do the poll again. So hopefully all of you know where your little poll thing is. It's below your name in the little room. So which of these do you think is a good qualitative question? You can only choose one. Why did the chicken cross the road? Why do chickens with cage layer fatigue illness decide not to cross the road? How many chickens cross the road within 1 week of visiting a chicken medicine office? And does the addition of an integrated behavioral health program to a chicken medicine office increase the likelihood that a chicken with cage layer fatigue illness will cross the road? So which one of those do you like to be a good qualitative question? So go ahead and find your little voting box and choose an A, B, C, or D. You may like more than one, but you're going to choose the one you like the best, which is a good qualitative question. I wish I had some Jeopardy music we could play while everybody's putting down their answers. I'm getting a sense it looks like a fair number of you have got it. If anybody's having trouble finding the little button where they put their number down, let me know. There it is. It looks like Vladimir put it back up for you. It's right kind of underneath your name there. All right. When Vladimir sends me back to my slide, we'll see what we got here. Okay. There's a little bit of variety. Most people chose A and B, and I would agree. Those are both good qualitative questions. I think question D is probably the way it's worded is really a pretty quantitative question. You know, I could ask, why did the addition of integrated behavioral health improve the likelihood? In which case, I'm getting more at a qualitative question. But when I'm asking about whether or not a very specific thing changes a likelihood, which is often a quantitative number, it's a better quantitative question. A and B are both good qualitative questions, but they're going to be studied in different ways. And you know, cage layer fatigue illness is really a chicken disease. This is why we have Google, because I looked up a chicken disease I could actually pronounce. All right, so we're getting our questions, and now we're thinking about what does it mean. So these tables are, I tweaked a little bit from Crabtree and Miller's really excellent book on how to do qualitative research, which is where I learned qualitative research like 20-some years ago from. So if we think about what we're going to do, sometimes in qualitative research we want to identify something, of course. What is it? What is important here? What's another type of description? We can do, of course, quantitative descriptions, you know, like how many people feel this way or how many, you know, patients have an A1C less than 9. But it's kind of in qualitative, it's more like what's going on here? What are dimensions? What variations? What is it? What is the lived experience? What is the value of this to our participants? We can even do some interpretation and associations in qualitative. We can ask about patterns, how do we view patterns, what kind do we see in observations, how do these phenomena that we're watching or asking about differ and relate to each other, how do things work, etc. And we can even sometimes test things and get some qualitative answers. So maybe we want to test a theory, or maybe we want to evaluate a program. You know, we can ask the type of qualitative responses. Does this original theory seem to fit in this plan? If I'm taking this model of education, will it fit when I'm looking at these different types of learners? Are there things that people tell me about what happens when X occurs? Are there changes that I can't count, but I can hear about when people talk to me? So a lot of times we're going to look at some of our aims as we think about where to move forward on a qualitative question. So what makes a good qualitative research question? Okay. It's when you want to know why something is happening, not is it statistically significant. You want to know how come something happened or how come people feel a certain way, not how many people feel that way. You want to know the reasons and the understanding behind behaviors, behind events, behind phenomena that happen. And you want to know what part of something matters, not by how much it matters. So in looking in practice research, practice-based research, and looking at maybe health services research, and you want to know about transformation, or you want to know about integrated practices, you may be getting more at, well, how important was this to you? Why did this part seem to make you change your mind, but not that part? All of those are great ways to think about qualitative questions. Okay. So from coming up with a question, we're going to talk about how our question determines our study design. And there's basically, in qualitative techniques and qualitative designs, three main ways we gather data and put things together. We can observe, we can review existing materials, and we can interview. And there's a lot of details within all of these. Observations can be highly structured, almost where you count things. They can be highly unstructured. You can be a participant observer. I can join in the practice and be part of that versus I'm just standing on the outside and looking in. And, of course, self-observation, self-reflection is a type of observation. Review of existing materials, documents, cultural products that exist, and interviewing. We're going to talk a lot about interviewing because that's probably one of the most common ways a study is put together in healthcare. Okay, so I had a great slide with a wonderful video all about observations that we were going to do together, and I just found out yesterday that this webinar platform won't let me show you videos. So we're going to send you later the link to the video, and you can do it on your own. So I'm sorry about not having a cool video to watch. Okay, observations once again. Use your little polling button. So which of these observations could be included in a qualitative study? What tasks medical assistants perform during a day in the office? What conversation occurs during an office staff meeting? How long patients wait in the exam room after the MA leaves but before the doctor arrives? And all of the above. You get to choose one of those answers. Hopefully you can find your buttons. Which of these observations do you think could be included in a qualitative study? It may be more than one, but just choose the one you like the best. There are answers popping up. I should make Jim Warner sing the song for Jeopardy because I can't sing.
I don't think you really want to do that.
All right, so we will take a look at what people have said. All right. Most people said D. They think all of these could be in observations, and I think you're exactly right. Some people said that B would be their favorite, or maybe C. All of these could also be done in a quantitative way. You could ask a medical assistant to do a checklist of tasks she does, or you could stand in the hallway and observe her and follow her around and see what she does. Conversations. Again, you could record the conversations and do a nice qualitative evaluation. You could also ask people, that one's a little bit harder to do more quantitatively, how long patients wait. You could grasp that from watching the patient walk in and then waiting outside until they know, and it's an observation. You could also have little timers set up and do it in a more quantitative way. So all of these types of observations are certainly appropriate to qualitative research. Okay, interviewing. All right. If there is If there is anybody on this list who has not ever done an interview, either research or clinical, just write, "I've never done one," in the chat room. Because I'm thinking and we're probably going to see nobody writing that. The really nice thing, and I think the reason that especially that primary care docs and family docs and nurse practitioners and people who deal with patients and nurses are really good at this type of research is because we're good at it as clinicians. You know, otherwise we would probably be pathologists. But because we're good at talking to patients, we are often really good qualitative researchers. A number of years ago, maybe 15 or 20, Will Miller and I wrote a manuscript about how to evaluate the quality of qualitative research. There's a lot, many more of those, how to evaluate quality of qualitative research has been published since then. And I included in your packet of readings a really good recent one by Deb Cohen. But when we first wrote this about 20 years ago, we used the analogy of clinical care pretty much throughout the entire qualitative research process because I think it's really one that resonates for us as clinicians or people who work in primary care. An unstructured interview is more or less a conversation. It's very much just talking without a lot of questions or anything, and there's no rhyme or reason about where you go. Semi-structured is probably the most common type of interview we do in healthcare and primary care research. It can be in a group setting or it can be as an individual, and there's lots of different kinds of individuals like we'll talk about. And a structured interview is very much kind of like doing a oral survey, if you would, an oral questionnaire, a spoken questionnaire. Structured interviews are appropriate when you know enough to ask specific quantifiable questions. So you can do things like, how important is this? You know, on a scale from 1 to 10, how commonly does something occur? Does it occur more commonly than this? Rank ordering things. You can use a little visual aids. I'm going to give you five examples of you know, how you could receive this communication in the office, and I want you to, you know, rank order them from 1 to 5 and show me which one you like. So just think about some highly structured questions, and if there were no open-ended questions as well, we would call it just a structured interview. When we include some of that with some open-ended questions, then we have more of a semi-structured interview. It's guided, it's focused, it's concentrated and open-ended. In many ways, we talk about co-creating between the investigator and the interviewee. And a clinical history taking is very much a great analogy for a semi-structured interview. So think about it. When I go in to see a patient, I really have an agenda of what I want to ask the patient, but the patient also has their agenda. I want to tell the doctor about this pain, and I want the doctor to do something to make it better, and I also want the doctor to see, you know, the hidden things that I'm really kind of ashamed to tell him and figure out that I'm also depressed. So I have an agenda of questions, but I'm going to use open-ended questions. And if the patient starts leading me down a road that looks a lot like depression, I'm going to follow where the patient is going. That's very much how a semi-structured interview would go. And just like a physician, I'm going to bring it back and hit some of the things I think are really important. Oh, I need to get your drinking and alcohol history. Oh, I need to get your family history. Oh, I need to know about that chest pain. The patient doesn't lead the whole thing. I give it some more structure and focus. That's a semi-structured individual interview. Okay. I'm supposed to ask you all for questions because nobody's writing any questions. So either this you've all fallen asleep or this is just so awesomeness you're just like can't stand it. Okay. So how do we choose the right semi-structured individual method? And this is kind of where you get into the literature and learn a little bit more about this. In-depth interviews, we take one topic and we really go into depth with it. Sometimes we have multiple interviews with a participant. Life histories, like doing personal biographies, oral histories. What are your personal experiences of some event? One that I see used more and more in medicine that comes kind of from the human factors field is critical incident techniques. Boy, this error happened or this event happened. Let's talk about it. Not just what went wrong, but also how you felt about it, and a lot of other deeper things can go along with that. All right, focus groups. The very first qualitative research I ever did was in focus groups. So I really have enjoyed using focus groups. It's a group of people, usually about 6 to 12, who've been selected because they have something in common to share their feelings about an issue, product, service, idea in a comfortable, permissive environment led by a skilled moderator. Okay, that's the perfect world. You who have done focus groups probably know it doesn't always turn out that way. All right, so if you've done a focus group, go into the little chat box and tell me the smallest focus group you've ever led. In other words, how many people more than one was ever in your group? What was the largest focus group you've ever led? Okay, so I've probably led the smallest focus group. It's probably been 3 people who showed up. And once when I thought I was only going to have like 11, I had like 27 people show up. Let me tell you, that didn't work. It was not very successful. So looks like some 2s, 3s, and 4s there. Yep. Somebody had a 15. I think that's getting a little large, and probably you felt that way too. We try for more than 12. Yeah, so when you have one, I don't think we can call them a focus group anymore, but sometimes we can do a nice individual interview. I'm not sure what the last one means. Oh, can't remember. There you go. Too big. Really big. All right. Well, 6 is nice. I like it when 6 show up. All right. So the most important thing I think that we have to remember about focus groups is that a focus group of 8 people does not equal 8 individual interviews. When I review manuscripts for various journals, probably this is an error I see a lot with early researchers. I don't see it as much as I used to anymore, which is good news. But when you try and pull out what somebody said, or try and, you know, count up that, you know, a lot of people were saying this kind of response or giving this kind of answer, we can't do that when we analyze a group, because as you can imagine, the whole group process changes how an individual might respond. So if somebody is starting to tell you about issues they have with their new electronic medical record, all of a sudden everybody in the group remembers way more things than they did than when you do an individual interview with them. It can be great because one of the things we want from a focus group is we want a lot of breadth, and we get that with a focus group. They also work really well when a power differential exists between participants and decision makers. Because if we're having a lot of people that are kind of like themselves in the group setting, they're going to feel a little bit stronger thinking that they're not in power with this powerful person coming in to interview them than if it's a lot of one-on-one interviews. It's respectful to the participants. It's a way to learn about the degree of consensus on a topic. Probably one of the things I learned the most way back when I started doing these was, I will date myself, it was shortly after the Nancy Cruzan decision. So for those of you who are really old, you will know that was an end-of-life and legal issue, and we were doing focus groups about end-of-life care. And in almost every focus group we were doing, most people were saying, gosh, it's really important to be sure to tell the doctor what to do because I don't want anybody putting a tube in me or keeping me alive when I don't want to be alive. And there would be an isolated voice that would start to speak up and say, you know, I just don't agree with that. And then the rest of the group would kind of shout them down. So I could tell that there was mainly consensus, but not quite enough. And I had to actually go out and try and find, I would ask these people to help me find other people that could be in that group. So what are disadvantages of focus groups? Well, they should be for research. Focus groups actually came out of marketing, but we have to be sure and structure them in a way that they're research and not just other things. It's got to be appropriate for a group discussion. Think about some issues that maybe you don't want to talk about in front of other people. So sometimes things like sexual issues, violence, racism, things that can be really tough to talk about. You have to be very sensitive to how you pull that group together. You're going to want those like-minded people who are comfortable talking among each other. If you're going to talk about use of birth control among teenagers, you probably don't want to have, you know, teenagers and their parents in the same group, for example. And of course, just like most interviews, you're not going to have anything you can use for statistics out of a focus group. Okay, so here is a possibility of how you might choose some methods to study something. You want to improve the provision of screening colonoscopies by clinicians in your PBRN. So to get started or along there, what might you do? You could observe clinicians discussing colon cancer screening with patients. You could do semi-structured individual interviews with clinicians and with patients. You could do focus groups of patients over 50. You could do a review of malpractice documents from cases where patients with colon cancer sued their primary care physician. So all of these are really reasonable ways to think about starting doing a study, but which one would you choose? So again, if you can find your little number, choose A, you want to observe, B, you want to do semi-structured interviews with clinicians, you want to do focus groups, you want to review malpractice documents. So hopefully you can all find your little number, your little letters. Which one would you personally choose? And don't put it in the chat box. Put it on the little place where you can choose underneath your name, where the little letter A is, and there's a drop down, and you can choose it. All right, looks like a lot of you have done that. I'm going to show it up here. All right, most people like B, semi-structured interviews with clinicians and with patients. One or two people liked doing observations of clinicians or holding a focus group. Okay, if you're one of the people who say B, write in the little chat box why you want to do semi-structured interviews with clinicians and with patients. So if you're one of the people who chose B, write in the chat box why that one appealed to you the most. I'm waiting to see something show up. Oh, I know it takes a while to write. Okay, one person liked it because it was a dyad situation. You can focus on both the clinician and patients. It liked both of them, that you had both the clinicians and patients. All right, so most people like the fact that it included both the primary care doctor and the patient. All right, did any of you like the fact that it was a semi-structured interview and you were more comfortable with that? Because I think that was also probably part of it. We also often choose the thing that we're most comfortable with. And I agree that you could do any of those. You're going straight to the data source. So I think looking at both of them and thinking about doing semi-structured interviews was a really good idea. All right, let's move a little bit forward. And we're going to talk about how we actually get to some of those people. All right, our sampling strategy, if you would. I think the most important thing to take away from choosing your participants is that you need to justify whatever reason you used or how you did it with the purpose of your study in whatever you write up or whatever grant proposal you put together. Because a lot of times one is not necessarily better than the other of the things we're going to talk about, but it is really important to say why you chose whatever, you know, group of participants or way to find your participants that you did, and justify why it was the right one for you. So I'm going to talk about a couple of key ways to do this. One of the more common ways is what we call a maximum variation sample. And this is basically where you try to get a little bit of everybody in your group. It's around whatever your topic of interest is. So, you know, if you're looking at colonoscopies, like a lot of you talked about, wow, we need the doctors and the patients, so we need a wide variation around those people. It's trying to get you the broadest range of information and ideas, your maximum variation sample. Key informants, a lot of people have liked to do key informant interviews. Your key informants are nice, they're cost efficient because you're very selectively choosing people who often have a good understanding of whatever it is you're going to study. The people you choose want to be people who know a lot about the topic, they're articulate, they can speak to you, they have good reflective skills. This is like, of course, in a perfect world, we're only going to find people like this. And they often are kind of a lead for you into the groups that you're going to be studied. And a lot of times, of course, you're going to interview multiple key informants. Like you may have some patient leaders, and you may have some physician leaders, and you may have some nursing leaders that you're going to do. Snowball, I love that. I love the visual of rolling the snowball down the hill and just seeing it picking up more and more snow, I think is such a great analogy here, which is essentially early participants suggest your future participants. You ask people, tell me who else thinks like you, or just the opposite. Tell me who out there kind of believes the opposite of you about this idea. Who out there also knows a lot? Who else do you think would be a good person to talk to about how pharmacists and physicians work together around this issue? Probably the other most common kind I see used is the purposeful, also called purposive, which basically means you're going to choose your participants specifically by various factors. Maybe you want patients with chronic disease, but you think it matters whether or not they're male or female, and it may also matter if they're over 50 or under 50, and it may also matter if they speak English or they don't speak English. So you may pull some demographics and say, I want to make sure that I talk to or I observe or I have in my focus groups people of multiple demographics or maybe experiences. I want people who've been injured by the procedure, and I want people who've had the procedure and never been injured. And of course, by outcomes, many times I want to find the absolute best practices who do the most superb job with their diabetic patients, and I want the practices that, you know, if they're lucky, they could tell you the name of two diabetics in the entire practice and know nothing about their outcomes. So you may choose around clinical outcomes, both patients and practices and stuff like that. But I would tell you, and I think I hope all of you would be honest, really the most common method we use is the convenient sample, the convenient group of participants. Who do you know? Where do you live? How much money do you have? How much time do you have? So often those are the factors that limit who our participants are in our studies. You kind of acknowledge that in your limitations, and you try to get the best sample you can, knowing that you have these limits of time, space, money, all those types of things. So you may do key participants, but you know you're going to be limited to, you know, no more than 8 or 10 because you just don't have the money or the time, even though you haven't reached what we call saturation, which is meaning nobody's telling you anything new. And you know you'd love to hit people in the rural area, but you live in the middle of a big city and you just don't have the time or money to get out to the rural area. You just acknowledge that as a limitation. All right. There was a real question. Would you agree that semi-structured interviews may include the input from the moderator and to be able to improve screening, maybe to find the areas of weaknesses through observations? You know, that it's so well said, because I think a really important thing is that you don't have to stick to just one type of study design. You may start out with interviews and go to observations. You may not even know what questions to ask, so you may want to just go spend some time in some practices and do some observations and then develop an interview guide. So you may want to do structured observations, and your interview guide is going to direct you to the things that you're going to specifically look for. So I think you are 100% correct that putting them together often works really well. It also, and probably one of the most common ways we see these two used in multi-method, is that the qualitative, be it observations or interviews or focus groups, are going to help define a more quantitative instrument or tool. Perhaps we're going to develop a survey, or we're going to develop an outcomes guide, or we're going to develop something along that line. We want input from patients. We're going to interview and observe and talk to patients to give us the input into that quantitative tool or instrument that we're going to use. On the other hand, maybe we're using a quantitative tool up front, and then we get a bunch of responses, and we're like, you know, I really have no idea what these mean. So maybe I need to go back to my patients or my participants or my clinical staff, whoever it was that, you know, filled out your quantitative tool, and ask them about, I noticed that a lot of people in our group responded very negatively to this question. Let's talk about why people might have responded negatively. So in other words, using it with quantitative tools both to help prepare better quantitative tools and to understand why people say certain quantitative things. Good question. Okay. Focus group participants need to be a little bit special. I learned focus groups from David Morgan, a social scientist who was at the University of Portland, at least he was 20 years ago, wrote a couple of really excellent books about doing focus group research. And he coined the term homogeneous strangers, which just struck with me. I like the way it sounds. Homogeneous strangers are people who are homogeneous around some area. It could be a demographic. I'm only going to have young people. I'm only going to have old people. I've got somebody's hold music on here. I don't know if you two do, but that's nice in the background. They may be homogeneous around how powerful they are. I've got all the CEOs of the hospital organizations together. And somewhere else, I've got a lot of Medicaid patients.
Appreciate your patience. Please stay on the line.
If that's you and could turn that off, that would be great. Strangers are traditionally preferred in a focus group. A lot of times, and maybe you've had this experience, sometimes couples come together, best friends come together, family units come together, and they kind of talk for each other. Or one person is afraid or ashamed or uncomfortable saying something in front of somebody they know pretty well. So it's sometimes nice if you have people who don't know each other very well. I've done a lot of focus groups actually in primary care practices, and of course, if you've got a lot of nurses together, they all work together. We do a focus group of nurses. They're not strangers, but you can't always do as best as you can. Sometimes you can do, of course, multiple groups. So I, when possible, would put physicians in one group and staff in another group, but sometimes we had to put physician and staff together just because it was a very small practice.
We sincerely appreciate your patience. We'll be back in a moment.
I'm sorry. Whoever has their phone, please put it on mute as we can hear you're on hold right now. I apologize, Dr. Elder. So again, if you do have your phone on mute,
that's fine.
Or even if you have your phone on hold, and Dr. L, that's not you at all, right? I'm just making sure.
No, it's not me.
Okay.
Nope, not me.
All right, you can continue.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. All right, so focus group participants, because you're putting people together and you want to get the best group, you have to be a little bit careful about putting them. But some of us have done natural groups. In other words, a group already exists, and I'm going to go there and hold a group interview with them. And sometimes that's just how it is. And it may be a group that comes together because they're part of something like my groups of nurses and doctors. Other times I will be able to put a group together just the way I want it. So we have to just kind of work around that and just acknowledge those limitations. All right, another poll. Okay, so you're going to select some participants. So you want to refine an intervention to increase screening for domestic violence in the offices, and you're going to use focus groups to gain some stakeholder input, and you have no money, at least I don't anyway, so I can really only afford to hold three groups. So which three groups do I think I'm going to try and do? A group of patients, a group of clinicians, and a group of office staff. Or I might choose a group of only women patients, a group of women clinicians and staff, and a group of men clinicians and staff. Or C, a group of women patients with a history of domestic violence, a group of women patients with no such history, and a group of men patients. Or D, a group of women patients, a group of men patients, and a group of clinicians and office staff. None of these are bad, but you only get to choose one.
Please hold the line.
So put your number down, excuse me, your letter, A, B, C, or D. All right. So start putting some. You have to choose one of these. I know they're a little complex. You have to take some time. And I want you to think about it because as you put your letter down, you have to choose one of these. take a moment and justify in the chat box why you are putting the selection that you're putting down. So you have to justify to your funder why you want to choose these specific participants. So go ahead and put your vote in. I know you have to think about this one. It's a little tougher. Come on, half of you haven't put it down yet, so we'll listen to the hold music in the background.
Thanks for holding. We appreciate your time and patience. Please stay on the line. We'll be back in just a moment.
It's like calling the cable company. All right, so some of you are putting it down, and some of you are putting down some answers. We'll take a look at what people have here. All right, so most people said none. That would be 10 of you who didn't answer the question yet. Okay, but those of you who did answer, some people chose a couple of all of them, but it looks like D, a group of women patients, a group of men patients, a group of clinicians, office staff. I like some of the ideas that are coming up here, and hopefully you're looking here at the chat box. Somebody said, I think it would be difficult to isolate people who have experienced domestic violence. Certainly true. You want to create a safe space for clinicians and staff, so you don't want to assume that we know who's got a history. Others said including a group of men patients is important, is my opinion. They're often overlooked, so really looking out for that group. Women patients may not want to be with male patients, giving the sensitivity of those who have a history of trauma, so that would be a reason for separating out the patients by their gender. You'd want to hear from women who've experienced domestic violence, and they may not be comfortable talking about it in front of patients who haven't, which is a good reason for trying to get a group the other way, and choosing a group that's inclusive of a lot of different groups. I think the key about choosing participants is exactly what you've done, which is you think about knowing that nothing is going to be perfect because we are often limited by funds or by time or by space. And so sometimes we can't do the perfect thing. Well, I'd like to do 27 focus groups very narrowly. So you have to kind of make the best sometimes of reality, and we justify why we chose it. And I think a lot of the reasons that you all just put down were very appropriate justifications. All right. Like this one here, the last one that came up right now was separating men and women would be an imperative, and domestic violence survivors would be a very sensitive group. It would be nice to have more than just survivors to get in the group. All right. We're going to talk a little bit about how you actually, once you've identified people and you know what you want to ask them about, how you actually collect the data. All right. Well, if you're going to interview them or observe them, you're probably going to have some kind of guide. You're going to have an interview guide. So as you put your interview or observation guide together, you start out, of course, with your research question, what do you want to know? And then your reality is, you know, how many can I afford to do and things like that? How long do I have for it? When we put interview guides together, especially for semi-structured interviews, we often have a few basic questions, just like, you know, the first question when a patient comes in the exam room and you want to make sure you always ask them, you know, what's your concern today? What brought you here today? But you may have probes which delve deeper into a question. What if somebody didn't understand my question? How can I rephrase it? So some prompts. There may be a couple of areas I want to make sure people talk about, but if they mention it in their open-ended response, I don't want to ask the question. So I just may have it off to the side to remind me if it wasn't answered that I'm going to add that. So those are probes and prompts. Some people in clinical practice, I certainly don't have my probes and prompts written down because I've been a clinician for 30 years, but certainly when I first start out in research and every time I do research because I want it to be more consistent between my interviewees, I'm going to write down potential probes and prompts on my interview guide so that I remember to ask them every single time. Most people will usually put demographics at the end, And you don't want to begin with the most sensitive question. You almost always want to begin with, if it's a semi-structured interview, of course, with some nice open-ended questions, but nothing that's terribly sensitive or puts people on guard at the very beginning. You want to kind of put those in after some trust and comfort has been decided. You can just do everything with a pencil and a paper or writing on your iPad or whatever it is, where you take brief notes during the interview, during the observation, and then later you go back and you expand those notes while they're still fresh in your mind. But I would say most people are going to do some type of recording. Audio tape is certainly less expensive and less intrusive than videotapes, but you don't get any of the nonverbal that might be there, but that videotaping can sometimes seem a little intrusive into somebody. So the audio tape versus videotape, it kind of depends on what your key questions are and how important that nonverbal is. You can always transcribe whatever recording you have, and now you have a text document that you can analyze or spend time with, but you can analyze directly from your recordings via listening and watching over and over as opposed to reading over and over. Regardless of whether or not you record and how you record or whether or not you just take data notes, you should always, in qualitative research, be taking researcher notes. You know, the best bench researchers always have their lab notebooks where they're jotting down what experiments and what's going on and things they found. Well, we need to do that in qualitative research, too. We want to describe the events, unexpected happenings, personal reflections about this. Wow, you know, I just really did not feel a connection with this interviewee, with this participant. It was like, you know, I was pulling teeth to get them to even talk to me. I can't figure out what was going on. And, you know, that helps you when you go back and look at the data. You'll know some of this was there. And it also helps you to be able to say, I hadn't even thought about a couple of things, but, you know, a couple of people are mentioning this, this new a bill that was just passed by the legislature and how it's going to affect their ability to talk to patients about certain issues. I wonder if I need to put that into future interview guides. So maybe I'm going to jot this down in my little researcher notes so I've got it there and can go back and look at it. Researcher notes always should be done no matter how you collect your data. All right. So how do you want to collect these data? So you've got an integrative and behavioral primary care and behavioral practice, and you want to describe interactions between providers. So you want to do props A, videotape observations of warm handoffs between the providers. So that you don't know, a warm handoff is where one provider actually tells the other provider about a patient as opposed to sending a written referral. Observe warm handoffs and make written notes about the interactions. Audio tape observations of warm handoffs between providers, or let's get real, I don't like doing observations and I want to do some interviews instead. Okay, which one do you want to do for your study? And the answers are slowly coming forward. No, they aren't. They all disappeared. Okay, they were there and they all went away on my little computer. Okay, now we'll see if they're back. All right, I'm not picking them up this time. I don't know what went wrong. Okay, let me try this again. All right. Most A's and B's, I thought sure we'd see some B's in there about people who really like to interview, but I guess you guys aren't like that. Okay, so videotaping or observing and making written notes. It seems like both most people, and please jot a note if I am interpreting this another the wrong way, that a lot of what we're thinking is going on in that interaction might be nonverbal. That we need to see how people look at each other, how they stand or sit, or the types of ways they're communicating that we're not going to capture in an audio tape. And because of that, I either want to watch it myself or have my researcher watch it and write some notes, or I want to videotape that I can see. If there's a different reason that you chose A and D, go ahead and write that down in the chat box for us. But I think this is a good example of where sometimes you need that nonverbal and other times you don't. All right. We're getting to analyzing the data, which I got to tell you is going to take another 2.5 hours to even do a quick review. But luckily, we're at 1 o'clock, and people need to be leaving soon. I know we're going to go on a little bit longer, but knowing that analyzing data, I like that answer about re-reviewing the content, especially if you have a videotape. That is so true. That's one of the really nice things about having recordings. Okay, that gets us into analyzing the data. What a nice segue. There are analyzing qualitative research data can be really fun, but it can also be really difficult. So the little cartoon there, I'm sure most of you have heard the story about the blind men. In this case, these are all the qualitative researchers who are exploring the data they have gotten back from spending some time observing or interviewing the elephant, and one of them says it's a rope, one says it's a wall, one says it's a snake. So depending on what part of the elephant you've been spending time with, it's kind of how you are going to interpret it. A good qualitative analysis plan is going to bring all those elephant researchers together so that we have a unified whole model. We have a summary understanding of where the data lead us. And I think that's a key component to think about. Now, to get there, it's time consuming. I cannot just call in my biostatistician because I'm not a quantitative person and say, run those stats for me and ship me the readout, you know, on the email next week. I actually have to sit there and do it and spend a lot of time with my colleagues in getting it done. So it's investigator intensive, but you know, I really enjoy it. Some of the best research times I've had have been sitting around talking about data, talking about how we can model the things that we're finding, talking about how it means to you, which is different than what it means to me, and going back and reading it again or reviewing the tapes again. So qualitative data analysis is fun, but it does take time. I'm going to talk about three basic ways of doing it, and I'm going to use the way that Crabtree and Miller did in their book, and I gave you that chapter as one of the readings. And they talk about using a template, using an editing style, and using an immersion and crystallization style. A template style basically means you've kind of got a code book that often you're going to have even before your data are collected. This is how I think I'm going to pull it together. In many ways, your template is your questions. For example, if you've got a survey or if you've done a structured observations, they may be your observation points. So your code book more or less kind of exists from what you asked about or what you observed. And then your code book is going to like look for structure and ideas and phrases that kind of fit in your codes. Now, as you go through the text or your recordings, you may find that your template is inadequate. And then you may need to make some modifications and revisions. And then you need to go back a second time. When you start getting to that point, you start getting into what Crabtree and Miller called the editing style, which is you kind of have a little bit of idea about what's going in there, because of course you do. You wrote the question, the survey questions or the interview guide, or you did some of the observations. So you have a little bit of idea of what's going on before you even got there. But once you get in there, you kind of look at the data and you pull out groups and categories as you read them. And then as you go into them again, you realize, oh, these things I called three separate groups are actually one group and I'm going to pull them all together. Or, oh, I thought I had one group here, but really there's six things in here. So you kind of keep moving it around as you look at things. And then you start looking at these categories and how they relate. And you can kind of go back to your data, your text, your recordings, and find the themes and patterns and models of how they all work together. It makes it sound so easy, doesn't it? Okay. Immersion and crystallization, I think, works best with small data sets. You really can't do this if you've got tons and tons of data. But it's where the researcher just spends a prolonged time with the text, if that's what it is, or the recordings or the notes. and emerges after concerned reflection and lots of discussion, this kind of intuitive crystallization of the data. And they can, you know, your group of researchers can do this multiple times. You don't code things. You may certainly going to jot down notes from each of your, you know, groups or times that you spend with your data, but it's not like you go in and code all of, you know, your interview documents or whatever you may have. Now, to be honest, there's a lot of overlap between these because it's kind of immersing yourself in the data during the editing style that helps you kind of come up with new categories. And it's having a little bit of a template when you start out at the very beginning to think about how you might want to organize your data. But these are some of the key ways that the Crabtree and Miller that I think really applies to all people who do qualitative research. And how you choose it depends a lot, going back to your original research question and what your aims were, how much you know about something, and who you're doing your research for. So if you know a lot about something, maybe it's more clinical, probably the template style because you know how you're going to look at those data. Editing or immersion styles, maybe you're doing more exploration. I don't really know what's going on here. I'm really trying to find this out, or I'm doing some participatory qualitative research. I'm bringing in my participatory partners. And of course, as we said, just like you're going to do observations and interviews perhaps, you're going to use multiple styles during this part. Qualitative software will not do the analysis for you. This is another pet peeve of mine, is when I read manuscripts that I'm reviewing or grants that I'm reviewing, and the data analysis for the qualitative is we will put it into Atlas TI, or we will put the data into InVivo and do the analysis. Personally, that's like saying, you know, we will put all these numbers into SPSS and an analysis will come out the other end. So that's, yeah, anyway. If you don't have qualitative software, does that mean you can't do it? I think it's really hard to do large data sets without some qualitative software. But you can certainly do small projects without any qualitative software at all. If you don't have a favorite, I'm an InVivo person, but that's just because that was the one I started with. I know a lot of people use Atlas TI. My ethnographic colleague has been trying to use Deduce, which has a free internet version. And so there's no one right way. There's a lot of institutions that kind of review them and compare them, and I gave you a quick review if you wanted to kind of look at them if you're thinking about getting them. And here we go. Okay. Before you answer this question, I realized I forgot to say one thing, and that's, okay, I'm too old. We're going to do this first. Okay, what is your biggest qualitative research pet peeve? Obviously, you're going to see some of my pet peeves in here. Okay, researchers who describe lack of generalizability to larger populations as a limitation to their study. Research methods whose entire qualitative analysis plan is qualitative analysis will be done using InVivo software. Research results from qualitative interviews which summarize the results for each question they asked. And those are all the results presented. And qualitative research methods described as sampling a random group of patients. Okay, now all of you can tell that all of those are my pet peeves, but I'm interested into which is your major pet peeve for qualitative research. So there was also a question about writing qualitative analysis in a manuscript, and this kind of leads to some of that there. So which of these is your pet peeve? Come on, keep answering. I know they're kind of long. All right. I think we've got a lot of them there. We'll take a look. All right. Well, nobody is as upset as I am about lack of generalizability to larger populations as a limitation to your study. So I will tell you why this should never be something that you write when we start talking about qualitative research is that your qualitative research should never have set out to be generalizable to a larger population. If you want to answer a research question that's going to be generalizable, then you need to do a quantitative type of project. So your limitations need to be related to the research that you're doing, and qualitative research describes the experiences, describes the phenomenon, describes whatever it is that you've chosen as your goal for this group of people. And hopefully it will inform others and have some believability by others in the community, but it's never going to be generalizable. So you need to find the limitations that are also there, that are really there. Boy, I didn't have enough money to interview everybody I wanted to. Boy, I didn't couldn't find anybody who fit this type of participant I wanted. So those are limitations that are appropriate. We already talked about how you should never say qualitative analysis will be done using in vivo software, unless, of course, you feel comfortable saying quantitative analysis will be done using SPSS as your entire research method. We talked at the beginning, when we talked about analysis, about how we want that whole elephant to be part of our model, to be part of our theory, to be part of our summary unit, our wholeness that we come out of our research with. And sometimes people say, gosh, I asked 6 questions, and here's a summary of the questions, the answers to question 1, and here's a summary of the answers to question 2. You know, then that's not really a qualitative analysis. That's a semi-quantitative analysis where I'm, you know, I can put it in a table and do a bar graph with it. I haven't thought about how do all these answers come together. How do we have a wholeness of all of my data? Well, I don't want just, you know, answers to 6 questions. I want you to tell me how it all comes together. Because maybe when somebody answered question 4, they really informed question 1. And I want you to take the time as a qualitative researcher to pull that together for me. And of course, in qualitative research, we really aren't looking for random people. Sometimes you just can throw a dart and take somebody, but randomization is not usually anything that we're looking for. Here's another pet peeve somebody wrote, conflating qualitative with subjective and quantitative with objective. Oh, that's really true, and I am really happy to say that's much less true now than it was 20 or 30 years ago. And I think that over the last 20 or 30 years, we've seen so many medical journals open to qualitative research, and I think so many more researchers are realizing that they can't get to the answer that they really want with just quantitative data, that it's important that we have both the qualitative and quantitative piece, and sometimes we only need the quantitative for a small piece of it, and sometimes we only need the qualitative. But really, to pull it all together, we need them both. And one is not objective and one is not subjective. They're both data, and when they're done well, they both help answer the questions that we have. There's a question about how you write qualitative analysis in a manuscript, and it varies based on what you're doing. And I would tell you probably what I recommend to new qualitative researchers is read at least 6 qualitative manuscripts or articles that have been published and see how people do it. And I think if you're writing a grant, I really encourage you to read other people's qualitative grants. My very first grant I wrote that had qualitative methods in it, I stole quickly and easily from my colleagues around the country. Hey, I noticed you just got a grant, funded where you're doing a series of focus groups about this. Can you show me how you wrote up your focus group methods for this funding agency? And I have found that in primary care, most researchers are really happy to help each other. So I think the best way to begin to write your qualitative analyses up is to look at other people's and see how they've written it. And then, of course, you're not going to copy what they've done, but there may be a few statements or personal places or ways they've phrased things that you can then say, gosh, well, I did it this way, not this way, but I like their phraseology. Qualitative manuscripts use words and not numbers, which means almost without exception, our work is longer. It's really hard to fit it into a brief research piece. It is often at the long end of being accepted for publications. Sometimes you can get around it. Maybe I'm going to put some example quotes in a table so I don't have to put them into the word count. But luckily, a lot of primary care journals want the qualitative work and are more accepting of the fact that a good qualitative article isn't going to be 2,000 words. It's going to be 3,900 words. Oh, and I really like this last question because I had forgotten to mention this, and this was something I wanted to say. The importance and necessity of using a specific theoretical framework when conducting and writing up qualitative work. And I really encourage you to read the chapter that I copied and put on as one of your readings out of Crabtree and Miller's book, because they do a really good job of talking about different theoretical and discipline models within which to do qualitative research. Some of qualitative research is done, of course, by our anthropologist colleagues. They tend to use ethnography. Others may be doing it from a philosophy point of view or from a nursing point of view. The nurses have kind of, nurse researchers over the years with qualitative research have very much been taken by grounded theory, which kind of is a sociological way of doing it. Others of us say, I have no idea what the heck you're talking about. I don't know an hermeneutic from a phenomenological, from a grounded theory, so how can I ever be a qualitative researcher? And the reason I didn't mention a lot of that, because that was me when I started doing qualitative research. I mean, like, I don't know what any of these words mean. I don't know how they possibly go into research, but yet here's a question I have, and I think interviewing people and talking to them is going to help me answer this question. So I think if you are doing a lot of research with anthropologists, they're going to want to be more ethnographic. They may be doing exactly the same thing that you, the non-anthropologist, are going to do, but they may call it a different word. So I think that if you're going to try and publish in perhaps an anthropological journal or a nursing research journal or a sociology journal, you may find that you need to use some of their language. On the other hand, you better use it right, because nothing can irk them more than calling something grounded theory when there's absolutely nothing in there related to grounded theory, or calling something phenomenological research when it's not. So, you know, make sure you bring in colleagues from that discipline to work with you. And I think that a lot of times in healthcare, you know, AHRQ, some NIH, they don't necessarily require that when you write your grants. But other times, you know, you may just have the bad luck of having two nurse researchers on your study section who are grounded theorists, and they can't believe you're not doing grounded theory. So I agree, but we've all been there. Here's a comment that says, often the feedback from reviewers is sort of, how dare you not be upfront about the theoretical model you're using. Many journal editors wanted to know exactly how you did the analysis, but then word limit a manuscript does not allow that detailed analysis. Oh, and those are both really true comments. And I will tell you, I think and I know the Family Medicine Journal the best, Annals of Family Medicine, JABFM, I do a lot for them reviewing. I've read a lot of qualitative work in JGM. And I don't think any of those primary care journals feel that way, or I know in the reviews I've done, some of it has come as grounded theory, and other times it's come as, hey, I did some qualitative work, and these are the tools I used, and this is the design I did, and these are the participants, and there's not a phenomenological or ethnographic or anything in there. So I think that it all depends on which journal you use, and sometimes with what, if you're doing a grant, sometimes it's just luck of the draw that you just get somebody that argues about that point. And I will agree that some people want a lot of detail about your data analysis, and then you just don't have the words to do it. So I can't stress to you enough, if you're sending something to Annals of Family Medicine, or if you're sending something to Journal of General Internal Medicine, read some of their qualitative publications and kind of see how they pulled it all together in a relatively short space. So learn from what's already been published in the journals you're interested in doing. Here's another question. How do you tidy? I suppose that's tidy up the, in the discussion of the theoretical model if you used it for guidance and methods. Well, you are really coming up with really tough questions. That's all I want to say to you. Because I have had this dilemma a couple of times. Because sometimes you do have some models that it's a brand new model. You develop this model during your data collection, and it probably belongs in the results, and then you're going to talk about it more in the discussion. And sometimes you've got somebody's piece of a model that you're kind of using a little bit during your analysis, and then it's going to be more. So where do you put it? Do you put it in your methods? Do you put it in your results and discussion? And all I will tell you, the answer is yes or no. And I think it's going to be partly the specifics of whether or not it was developed more out of your data, in which case you're probably going to throw it into your results and discussion, or whether or not you used it a little bit in the beginning. I'm currently writing up a qualitative paper where we kind of used some existing models and analyzed our data using some of these models basically to show that there's big gaps in the model that exists. So in that case, the models are introduced into the method section, and we talk about using them as part of our methodology. I probably didn't answer the question thoroughly. Otherwise, as opposed to the discipline theory, you just going to use it throughout. You're going to, if it's a phenomenological approach, then you are going to hopefully use that in your methods, and your results and your discussion are going to be spun in a phenomenological manner. Any other questions? Because I think I'm like at the end here. Look at that summary. Don't forget, a good research question sets the foundation for the rest of your research. Don't skimp on the time you spend on your question, because, boy, if I want to know something that really I need to watch people to get at, because that's what I really want to know, then I better put some observations in. So that question is going to go into the study design. It's going to go into who am I going to look at, the kind of things that, that most of you pulled up on some of our chat discussion. Hey, these people aren't going to want to be in the same room together. It matters how I put them separately. And, of course, data collection and data analysis. And as I said, with data analysis and writing for a manuscript, it's another many hours that we could have as all of you came up with your questions. So I am done unless there are any more questions or comments. Jim, I'm giving it back to you.
Okay, great. Thank you, Nancy. Thank you so much. That was a great introduction and discussion of, really from A to Z, how to do qualitative research, particularly if you're relatively unfamiliar with it. And I'll just, make a comment or two, not nearly as experienced as you are, Nancy, in doing qualitative research. But, one of the things that I really did when I began doing qualitative research was I really used those Crabtree and Miller books because they are really based in primary care-based, grounded in primary care-based qualitative inquiry. And many of you may be familiar with those. But if you're not, I think they're excellent resources, as Nancy was saying. You have a book chapter from one of those in your readings. And if you need a guidebook, if you're relatively close to the beginning of your knowledge of doing practice-based qualitative research, I would suggest to get a copy of Crabtree and Miller, either the first or second edition of that book. And it helped me a great deal. And one of the things that I know Ben Miller has talked about quite a bit is that practices are They have their own cultures, and as such, they lend themselves very well to ethnographic inquiry. And so, you know, I think a lot of us ascribe, become over a period of time of doing qualitative research, ascribe to a certain approach, methodology, paradigm, whatever you might want to call it, and ethnography seems to work pretty well. Although I think tailoring your methods to the question as well as the setting is also important. So just a little bit from me on qualitative research. So I want to do a little bit of housekeeping, though, before we end for today. So the deadline we have for your concept papers to be finalized and submitted to the certificate program directors, that'd be L.J. Fagnan, myself, and Amanda Ross, the coordinator, is April 15th. So that's coming up soon. That's in 8 days or so. You'll also want to submit it to your mentors and your PBRN director and other people that were involved in your concept paper. If you're going to have any difficulty making that deadline, please contact me by email. Let me know what kind of challenges you might be facing and what your timeline looks like in doing that. Otherwise, we'll assume that you'll be submitting it on or before April 15th. Okay. Okay. And then finally, on April 21st, we have another webinar. So we have two this month. And this is our 10th session, and it's entitled, What You Don't Know Can Hurt You, Lessons About Complexity from the PCORI IBH-PC Pragmatic Trial. And this webinar will be led by Dr. Roger Kessler, Dr. Constance O. Van Egan, both from the University of Vermont College of Medicine. And I think this is going to be really interesting because as in some of our prior webinars, we've gotten into, as people have described their studies as part of another, getting at specific principles or methods, we've gotten into some of the tangled web of doing complex research studies in busy practices. And this particular webinar is really going to go into much more depth about that. And that trials may seem to be, using a trial design in particular, may seem to be straightforward. In fact, the devil is in the details. And so we want to learn from those with a great deal of experience about the obstacles and barriers and challenges that they faced and how they've overcome those. And so we have a great opportunity to learn from Dr. Kessler and Van Egan on the 21st. So please join us for that webinar. Okay? All right. Well, we will end for today. And Dr. Nancy Elder, thank you so much for sharing your expertise and your experience with us today. We'll let everyone go a couple minutes early. Thank you so much. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.